I'm Dr. Gary Namy. It's Labor Day here at Workplace Bullying Institute. Abraham Lincoln said labor is prior to and independent of capital. Capital is only the fruit of labor and could never have existed if labor had not first existed. Labor is the superior of capital and deserves much the higher consideration. He got it right, didn't he? There are so many more of us who work for a paycheck and work for a living than who are in the investor class. And more than ever, we're noticing that the class difference is leading to a tremendous inequality. But that inequality, that money fever, actually was well addressed by Mark Twain. You see, he had gone west to hunt for gold, and he said that California get-rich-quick disease of his youth spread like wildfire,
produced a civilization which has destroyed the simplicity and repose of life, its poetry, its soft romantic dreams and visions, and replace them with the money fever, sordid ideals, vulgar ambitions, and the sleep which does not refresh. It has created 1,000 useless luxuries and turned them into necessities and satisfied nothing. It has dethroned God and set up a shekel in his place.
Thank you, Hal Holbrook. He's performing Mark Twain tonight, theatrical invention of his that he's been performing since 1954. Now, that poetic reference to shekel, of course, is indeed what became the robber baron era of Mark Twain's lifetime, the Gilded Age at the turn of the 19th century, when it became the 20th. Those robber barons flourished until they crashed the stock market in 1929. FDR was elected at the Democratic National Convention in 1936. At the end of his first term, prior to his re-election for his second term, he made the following declaration at the convention in Philadelphia about economic royalists.
Economic royalists carved new dynasties. New kingdoms were built upon concentration of control over material things. And so it was natural and perfectly human that the privileged princes of these new economic dynasties, thirsting for power, reached out for control over government itself. The hours that men and women worked, the wages they received, the condition of their labor, these had passed beyond the control of the people and were imposed by this new industrial dictatorship. The savings of the average family, the capital of the small businessman, the investments set aside for old age, other people's money. These were the tools which the new economic royalty used to dig itself in. Throughout the nation, opportunity was limited by monopoly. For too many of us, the political equality we once had won was meaningless in the face of economic inequality. A small group had concentrated into their own hands an almost complete control over other people's property, other people's money, other people's labor, other people's lives. Against economic tyranny such as this, the American citizen could only appeal to the organized power of government. We well remember that the collapse of 1929 showed up the despotism for what it was. The royalists I have spoken of, the royalists of the economic order, have conceded that political freedom was the business of the government, but they have maintained that economic slavery was nobody's business. They granted that the government could protect the citizen in his right to vote, but they denied that the government could do anything to protect the citizen in his right to work and his right to live. These economic royalists complain that we seek to overthrow the institutions of America. What they really complain of is that we seek to take away their power.
Well, here you have FDR, a patrician, a wealthy man, taking the cause of the disenfranchised, the poor. And I don't think we've seen it since in the United States. We long for it. You know, Justice Louis Brandeis said, we can have democracy in this country, or we can have great wealth concentrated in the hands of a few, but we can't have both. Which brings us to the current. Andrew Cuomo, New York State Attorney General, prepared a report in summer 2009 titled No Rhyme or Reason, The Heads I Win, Tails You Lose, Bank Bonus Culture. And if this isn't an affront to labor, and an in-your-face poke in the eye, and a total sign of disrespect, nothing is. Now, I'm not talking about the report. I'm talking about the fact that he tracked the original 9 recipient banks, the ones who got the TARP money, the federal bailout money, in the fall of 2008 in the Bush administration. And what he did was he tracked their income during that period and the bonuses that were paid out. And what he did is he showed it violated every basic tenet of fairness that we operate by. Now, you, the working stiff, are always told, you know, if you do really, really well, you're going to get paid really well. And of course, that's not been necessarily true. They always carp about not having enough money, and they can't do this and that. And one of the myths floated around is that bank executives are so valuable that they cannot afford to be lost, so they have to be highly compensated. But the truth is, they ran their banks into the ground, the speculative ground, and they crashed the worldwide economy with their speculation coming out of Wall Street. The point is, there's no connection between pay and performance in the financial sector, which is the largest sector of our U.S. economy now. We have a small set of people who make money off of other people's money. Just as Roosevelt said, other people's money, he was talking about what happened during the Great Depression. Mark Twain was talking about what happened during the Gilded Age, and now here we are in our new Gilded Age. Now, I don't want to go through too many statistics here because I want you to be able to go and read the Cuomo report. So we'll provide the link right here on the podcast page. 2 highlights. Morgan Stanley received $10 billion in TARP funding. Here's what they've done. In 2008, they earned $1.7 billion. Sounds good, right? But they paid out $4.5 billion in bonuses. Let's say that again. In 2008, what Morgan Stanley did is they paid out 721% of their income in bonuses. Say, what if your boss came to you and said, I could give you a 10% bonus if you really crunch down, press hard, and get this report out, and we win the contract, okay? That sort of thing, that proposal writing. 10%, you'd be elated, right? How about a 721% bonus? But Morgan Stanley didn't stop there. Morgan Stanley, in the first 2 quarters of 2009, well now into the Obama administration, when supposedly the public is outraged by this conduct, paid bonuses of 2,617%. 261 times what the income was. And the second example is J.P. Morgan Chase received $25 billion in TARP funding, original TARP funding. Now, in 2008, they earned $5.6 billion, but they paid out $8.6 billion in bonuses. Here we go again. We're paying out more than we make. J.P. Morgan paid out in 2008 405% bonuses. Their bonuses paid in the first quarter of 2009 were a whopping 354%. So under public scrutiny, it came down an itty-bitty bit. And in the second quarter 2009, when the recession hits everyone and foreclosures are going crazy and layoffs are abundant, Morgan is paying its executives a bonus of 250% of what income the company has. The only money they have is to pay bonuses is the money we gave them. So the marketplace has a built-in immorality. Let's go back to FDR's 1936 address and see what he says about that.
It has been brought home to us that the only effective guide for the safety of this most worldly of worlds, the greatest guide of all, is moral principle. We are poor indeed if this nation cannot afford to lift from every recess of American life the dread fear of the unemployed that they are not needed in the world. But the immortal Dante tells us that divine justice weighs the sins of the cold-blooded and the sins of the warm-hearted in different scales. Better the occasional fault of a government that lives in a spirit of charity than the consistent omission of a government frozen in the ice of its own indifference.
So on this Labor Day, let's reinstate morality. Let's quit lauding the profits of the banks and pay attention to the fact that it has nothing to do with us, the working person. Lincoln had it right back in 1861. Labor is the superior of capital. Let's quit worshiping capital. Twain warned us. Studs Terkel is another person who had it right, a constant champion for the underdog who passed recently, a great advocate. And he wrote that work, by its very nature, is about violence. Violence to the spirit as well as to the body. It is, above all, or beneath all, about daily humiliations. To survive the day is triumph enough for the walking wounded among the great many of us. We at the Workplace Bullying Institute know all too well about the working wounded, and we know who's doing the wounding, and we know that it has to stop if we are indeed to be a moral nation. And finally, I turn to a hero of mine, Harry Chapin, whose grandfather taught him the value of how to spend a day and take pride in work.
There's two kinds of tired. There's good tired and there's bad tired. He said, ironically enough, bad tired can be a day that you won. But you won other people's battles. You lived other people's days, other people's agendas, other people's dreams. And when it was all over, there was very little you in there. And when you hit the hay at night, somehow you toss and turn. You don't settle easy. He said, good tired, ironically enough, can be a day that you lost. But you don't even have to tell yourself, because you knew you fought your battles, you chased your dreams, you lived your days. And when you hit the hay at night, you settle easy, you sleep the sleep of the just, and you can say, take me away.
Well, I hope you can sleep the sleep of the just. This Labor Day is probably a good time to rest and reflect on your importance, your soul, your health, and refuse to be bullied. Please visit the Workplace Bullying Institute website at workplacebullying.org. Thank you.